Hi everyone, my name is Claire Tomlin and I'm a professor of electrical engineering and computer sciences at Berkeley, and this is the 30th module in a series that we're recording to support the course EECS 221A Linear System Theory at Berkeley. So in previous modules we've been talking about the system, the linear system representation, both time varying and time invariant, and in the recent previous modules we've been talking about Jordan form and functions of a matrix, basically to simplify our task of computing the matrix exponential e to the at, which comes into the solution of the linear time invariant system. Now we're going to move on to our next main set of modules in the course, which are related to stability, system stability. So when we're analyzing systems, this is typically one of the first things we look at. First of all, what is stability and what does it mean? And why is it important for a system to be stable? But also, how do we characterize, by just looking at the system model, whether or not the system is stable? Okay, so we're going to basically have two different types of stability: bounded input, bounded output stability, so input-output related stability, as well as internal or state-space stability. So in this module, we'll introduce the concept of bounded input, bounded output stability. And this is, it's known as BIBO, just from the initials, so bounded input, bounded output stability, BIBO stability. And we'll see why it's called BIBO stability in a second. But first of all, let's step away from our state-space point of view that we've been focused on over the last several lectures and think about more of an input-output point of view for a system. So I like to think of a system as a block diagram with having an input, U, and that having an output, Y. So for a physical system, the inputs might be things that you can manipulate. So a mechanical system, you could manipulate things like you could apply forces to the system. You or an automated controller, for example, could apply through various actuation surfaces, electrical signals or forces or torques to be able to get the system to move in different ways or to display different properties. And then typically we measure parts of the system. So we measure positions for a mechanical system, velocities, for example. We might measure temperature of a system. And those are the outputs, the things that we measure. So let's represent then the internal workings. Oh, and an important thing to mention is this could be a multidimensional input, and this could be a multidimensional output. So in general, we've had our inputs belonging to, so at a particular point in time, the inputs belong to R and I, and the outputs belong to R and out. So it's typically a multi-input, multi-output system. So we use the following representation for the input-output relationship of the system. We'll call it capital H of T, comma, tau. This is a matrix. So it's going to be a matrix that has as many rows as there are outputs and as many columns as there are inputs. So I could think about this matrix H in general, we'll just write a representation here, as having elements, say, little h11 of t tau up to h1ni of t tau down to hn out 1 of t tau all the way over to hn out ni of t tau. Okay, so an input-output relationship. So generally describing the relationship between the, so for example, the first input and the, in this case, the NO, the number of outputs, that particular output, the first input and the last output, or the last input and the last output, or the first input and the first output. Now, what are these individual functions, H of T tau? Well, they're such that we can represent the output as a function of the input. So in general, y of t is given as the integral from minus infinity to t of h of t tau u of tau d tau. Okay, so they're a way to represent the system functionality such that this operation, this multiplication and then subsequent integration, gives you the corresponding output vector. Okay, so again, this is a matrix multiplication, and it gives us a matrix or a vector output. Okay, so h of t tau is typically called the weighting pattern or the weighting function. Weighting function. And it, as I said, it describes the input-output relationship of this system. Okay, so let's think about some systems we're familiar with. So the linear time-varying case characterized by the matrices A of t, B of t, C of t, and D of t. So for the linear time-varying system, LTV, given what we see here, we know that H of t tau can be written as the following. So it's C of t, the matrix C of t, times the state transition matrix, phi of t tau, times the input matrix, B of tau, plus D of t, the direct coupling between the input and the output, times delta of t minus tau. Okay, so if you take this function of t and tau and you integrate it between from tau going from minus infinity to t, then you'll end up with the input, like the output function as a function of an input, the relationship that we would expect for linear time varying systems. Linear time invariant systems, everything simplifies. So in the linear time invariant case, where the matrices A, B, C, and D are time invariant, then H of T tau, it no longer independently depends on T and tau. It depends on the difference between T and tau. So that's equal to H of T minus tau. And it's given by C e to the A T minus tau B plus D. Okay, so those are the weighting patterns for the systems that we're used to, the linear time varying and linear time invariant systems. And so you can test for both of those that if you compute this integral, you will get the output that we're familiar with from, you know, calculating the response of our linear systems. Okay, those are the weighting patterns. Now, what is bounded input, bounded output stability? Well, as its name suggests, it's basically asking, or it's characterizing systems for which the output remains bounded if a bounded input is applied to the system. Okay, so that means that if you apply an input and that input is bounded, and when we say bounded, we mean in the norm, typically that the infinity norm of that function, so over a period of time, the largest value that that vector can take on for t ranging over the time of interval of interest, if that function is bounded, then given this weighting pattern of the system, then the output would be bounded. Okay, so it's a property of the system that for bounded inputs, bounded outputs result. All right, so let's write down the definition of bounded input, bounded output stability now that we have a sense of how to represent a system in terms of this weighting pattern. Okay, so we say that the linear system, let's just call it L, is bounded input, bounded output stable if there exists some finite k, so k is some real number, it's finite, so it's less than infinity, such that for all input functions, which are bounded, so we write that as they belong to L infinity, and they're generally of dimension ni, the output, or the infinity norm of the output, can be bounded to be less than or equal to the infinity norm of the input. Okay, so if U is indeed bounded, then the output is going to be some bounded number k multiplied by that bounded number, so it will be bounded. Okay, so the easier way to state this is that the linear system is bounded input, bounded output stable if bounded inputs, all bounded inputs, produce bounded outputs. Okay, so let's think about this. I mean, it's more useful. So the definition is interesting, but what's useful is to be able to just look at the system, look at something to do with the model of the system, and be able to immediately say yes or no, the system is or is not bounded input, bounded output stable, because it's impossible to try to characterize all bounded inputs and test it that way. And so the useful theorem, which is useful for, I think, a theorem-proving technique in the time-varying case, and is computationally useful in the time-invariant case, is the following. Theorem, which is our bounded input, bounded output stability theorem. So the linear system is bounded input, bounded output stable. And our system L can be time varying in general, if and only if the following condition holds. The supremum over all t, and we'll say all t on the real line, of the integral from minus infinity to t of the norm of the weighting pattern, so h of t tau. So the induced infinity norm of the weighting pattern d tau is finite. So it's defined to be some k which is less than infinity. OK, so what we're saying here is that if we knew what the weighting pattern is, then we could calculate its induced infinity norm, integrate that result from minus infinity to t, and look at the supremum of that result over all t. And if that is finite, then the system is bounded input, bounded output stable. All right, so that is quite a mouthful, and it's not something that's computationally easy to check. Generally, as we saw for the linear time varying case, this is not easy to compute. It involves the state transition function. You know, the rest of this makes it hard to compute, especially that supremum over t. So this is more of a, I would say, a mathematical statement about characterizing bounded input, bounded output stability, which can then, I mean, it's not inconceivable that we could compute this, but as I said, I think it's more useful as, I call it, a theorem-proving machine, mainly because now if we want to take simpler systems, so simpler classes of systems than just the general linear or time-varying system, then we can use this characterization to compute simpler computational ways of determining bounded input, bounded output stability for those simple systems. And so, as we always do, the prime case is for the linear time-invariant case. So if we look at how this specializes to the linear time-invariant case, we have the following result. So theorem, which is the following. Suppose we consider the LTI, the linear time invariant case, then we know that the transfer function, so the relationship between the input and the output, is given by, so y of s is equal to h of s, u of s. In this case, h of s is the Laplace transform of the weighting pattern for the linear time invariant system, that h of t minus tau that we presented a few slides ago. And for a linear time invariant system, h of s, we can just write it down by inspection, is given by c si minus a inverse b plus d. Okay, so that's called the transfer function matrix of the system, and it's written in terms of the Laplace domain. So in the linear time invariant case, we can evaluate bounded input, bounded output stability just by looking at properties of that transfer function matrix. And the result is as follows, that our system L is bounded input, bounded output stable if and only if. Okay, so what does this condition translate to? It translates to something a little easier. The integral from 0 to infinity of c e to the a t b dt is finite. Okay, so in the linear time invariant case, we can just replace the supremum over t of the integral from minus infinity to t with just the integral from 0 to infinity. And that's equivalent to saying that the poles of the transfer function h of s are all in the open left half plane. So we write the open left half plane like that. It does not allow us to include the j omega axis. All of the poles have to be, so if this is the complex plane, they all have to be in the open part of the left half plane, not including the j omega axis. Okay, so if this is the case, then the system is bounded input, bounded output stable. Okay, so we're going to move on and think about now examples of this and how we might try to basically use this idea. So this is just a simple test. We compute the transfer function and we look at the poles. We can prove all of these results. So we can prove bounded input, bounded output stability is equivalent to this statement here. We're not going to do it in these modules. And then we can also prove these equivalences easily. So this is just a restatement of this. But this last statement about the poles of the transfer function comes immediately from considering the basically this statement here. Okay, so in the next module, we're going to move on to the characterization of state space stability, but we're going to come back and do some examples comparing bounded input, bounded output stability with state space stability, in which we'll use this characterization for the LTI case. We'll look at the poles of the transfer function just to as a test of whether or not the system is bounded input, bounded output stable. Thanks very much.